alongside Francophonie, which is visible, more or less transparent, legitimate, accountable, and so on, there exists an occluded French apparatus, a covert network whose quasi-imperial tentacles stretch throughout Africa. This is the world of Francafrique.
Hello, sir. Welcome to Dictatours. We're showing you residence standing. It's from dictators from other time French colonies in Africa. They're showing their gratitude nations to motherland by buying houses in some of the most expensive areas in Paris prestige.
Why shouldn't the dictators of these African nations buy property in Paris? After all, their countries are still de facto French colonies, semi-detached, partially dependent nations whose citizens are also semi-detached and partially dependent. Hence the ambiguity about national identity, hence the opposing pulls of an imaginary Africa that can't be left behind, and a too real France.
Now, monsieur, we are Avenue Foch. President Andimo, President of Gabon, has 5 properties here out of 39 total in France. He's a very nice man. He loves expanding his waistline, he loves election that he wins, he loves supercars and Jacques Chirac, Barack Obama. He loves Nicolas Sarkozy, little Nicolas Sarkozy, and bossa nova music, as I recall.
Francafrique has been a boon to conspiracy theorists. It comprises a supposedly ubiquitous web, a shadowy web, of course, of backhanders, back-scratching, backstairs diplomacy, aid, clientelism, gun-toting tyrants, bent elections, arms contracts, infrastructure contracts, digital contracts, torture, secret treaties, blind eyes.
Avenue Foch is very popular with dictators. Very popular. There is property of Blaise Compaoré. Blaise Compaoré is president of Burkina Faso. Blaise Compaoré enjoys elections. He enjoys, his people and their gratitude nation. He enjoys guiding his people's resources. He enjoys using his people's resources to heaven send his people. And he enjoys meeting Barack Obama very much.
Several careers have been founded on berating successive French governments' responsibility for child soldiers, genocides, famines, dictators' palaces, dictators' menageries, and, of course, on exaggerating French complicity. Exaggeration is the lifeblood of conspiracy theory. It justifies the paranoiac's very existence. Nonetheless, it cannot be denied that France had begun meddling in the affairs of its 14 former African colonies before the ink was dry on the treaties of independence.
So, this is Avenue Rap, monsieur. Denis Sassou Nguesso, president of Congo, has a wonderful apartment right here. He loves his people and their gratitude nations. He loves making money out of oil. He loves art deco. He loves spending the money he makes out of oil. He loves big drinks with sweetener wholesale. You know, President Sassou Nguesso has many, many academic competencies.
And his family have
112 bank accounts in France alone.
Meddling in Africa on the sly demanded, and still demands, stealth, secrecy, and suitcases. De Gaulle's chief fixer, who would serve a further 4 presidents, was Jacques Foccart, a man who made octopuses look under-tentacled. Every coup, every mercenary force, every armor-plated car, every special advisor, every assassination, every Croesus-sized peculation, every training program, every disappearance seems to have led back to this protean operator who counted as a personal friend, Mobutu Sese Seko, the kleptocrat's kleptocrat. Even though Zaire had formerly been a Belgian colony, Mobutu was paid by France throughout the Cold War to resist Soviet incursion.
And he was paid so well that his property portfolio was fatter than that of any other dictator, which is manifestly unfair. His crimes and those of numerous other tyrants, some of them severely underhoused, were indulged. For these were not any tyrants. These were France's tyrants, the West's tyrants.
And their crimes, genocide, looting their country, were, according to the dictates of realpolitik, puny. They were the price to pay for loyalty. Loyalty is granted to the highest bidder. France outbid Moscow. Foccart operated in a crepuscular world of great brutality, greater omerta, and fluid certainties. What he did and what he didn't do is unknowable. Still, he never denied having ordered the murder by rat poison of a Cameroonese opposition leader. Equally, there can be no doubt that at the very moment when his ruthless counsel was most needed, he was out of favour.